mentioned about the gray hair on the table and back, we've got prayer cards for you out there. And there's less color in the hair than there used to be. We went up to the Upper Peninsula this spring to Curtis, Michigan, up by Big Mastique Lake. And we were going to do some preliminary work up there, getting things ready for water, sewer, electric, all of that for our missionary builders to go up there and do some work at Curtis. And on the way with our travel trailer, I thought, you know, we're going to be all the way up there right by Big Mastique Lake. We might as well try a little fishing. My brother was going to be up there fishing. He had a boat and everything, so I thought, well, let's go freeload off my brother. We'd do a little fishing. So on the way up there with our travel trailer, we blew a tire on it. We did catch some nice fish. Somebody else caught the big fish, though. This, I thought we did good with these smallmouth bass. This guy comes back with a 36-inch pike, and then he caught a 41-inch pike, a 42-inch pike, and a 43-inch northern pike. We cut this 43-inch pike open. He had swallowed a 24-inch pike, and he was still hungry, apparently. But on the way back down from up there, we blew another tire on our travel trailer, and we're out in the middle of nowheres, it looked like, up by, was it Clear Lake, and Verizon forgot to put on their map where there's an area where there's no cell phone service. So I saw a road down ahead, and we went down there, and I thought, well, we'll get off the main road here, such as it was. And it turned out to be the entrance to the campground, so I'd go hobbling into there with our trailer because I don't have a spare anymore. We put that on up in the Upper Peninsula, so we're hobbling along, flopping this tire going down the road, and get into the campground, and finally this fella says, well, if you want cell phone service, you go down by the lake, you stand on your left foot, hold your finger way in the air, and you can maybe get a signal. So we tried it, it worked, and so we had to wait until we could get more tires brought in for us for our trailer. Did $7,000 damage to our travel trailer. But in the meantime, we're hobbling in there trying to patch things up as best we can so we can try to get back home with the trailer. And this fella on the lot across from us where we had pulled our trailer in, he and his buddy are over there talking, and he comes over to us in his motorized wheelchair that he's got. And he said, my buddy and I were talking. We thought we better come over and help them old folks. So we're officially old folks now. Oh, goodness. But anyhow, we're going to look at a couple of fellows in the Old Testament today. This message is entitled, What Are You Accomplishing for God? And we're going to look at Exodus chapter 31, verses 1 through 11 to start with here. And I'd like to ask you, what is your motivation in life? What are you accomplishing for God? Two men we're going to look at today are Bezalel and Aholiab. A couple uncommon Bible names. At least to us, probably only a Hebrew scholar can pronounce them correctly, but we'll take a stab at it, and I think they'll probably forgive us. But beginning in Exodus chapter 31, verse 1, it says, And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. Stop there a minute. Why do you suppose that God was so specific in telling the lineage of Bezalel here? Could it be that as Moses is leading all of these Jews out of Egypt, historians tell us that there's at least a million, maybe as many as a million and a half people that are leaving Egypt, that Moses is leading out of the Egypt up to the promised land. Good chance that, as uncommon as these names sound to us, within that group of people there could very well have been others by the name of Bezalel back then. It may have been as common as John or Jim is to us. We don't know. But God was very specific. Was Moses having any trouble with the Jews leading them out of Egypt up to the promised land? Of course he was. We read in Scripture how that his own brother and sister, Aaron and Miriam, came to him and voiced their objection to his leadership, thought he was taking on more authority than what he ought to. And so there was some feelings against him that were negative. And so God was very specific in this, because reading through historical writings that are left for us by Jewish rabbis, we find out that Hur is the son of Miriam, Moses' sister. Who was Miriam's husband? Anyone know? Who was one of the two spies that brought back a good report of the promised land? Caleb. So Miriam's husband was Caleb. So Miriam and Caleb had a son, Hur. So Hur was therefore the nephew of Moses. Exodus chapter 17, verses 10 through 12 say, "So Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and he took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stood up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun." So they were in a battle, and Moses was to stand there with his hands up in the air through this battle, which took hours and hours and hours. And just like we would have, his hands got heavy and he couldn't hold them up. Well, when his hands fell down, the Israelites started losing the battle. So he had to hold his hands back up again so they could start winning. His hands would get heavy and they'd come down. They'd start losing again. So Aaron and Hur got this stone, rolled it over there, set Moses on it, one on one side, one on the other side, and they held his hands up so that they would win until the battle was done, and they ended up winning the battle. So Hur was, I guess for lack of a better term, the sidekick of Moses. He was one of his closest friends there helping him in this battle. Historians also tell us that as Moses was up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights, getting the tablets of stone with the Ten Commandments on it, that Aaron had built this golden calf, and Israel had sinned, started worshiping this golden calf. Hur was there with the people, and he tried to stop them from creating this grievous sin before God and worshiping this golden calf that Aaron had made, and for that he had been martyred. Continuing to look forward here, we find out that Uri was then the son of Hur, which makes Bezalel, the son of Hur, the great-grandson of Miriam, and makes Bezalel the great-grandnephew of Moses. So we find out through historian, the record they have left for us, the reason why God was so particular in telling the lineage of Bezalel, because he wanted to make sure the people knew that it was his choice for Bezalel to lead this building of the tabernacle there. It wasn't Moses' decision to have a relative do it, make this a family affair, building this tabernacle. It was God's choice. How many of you have had a 13-year-old son? How many of you have said to yourself, if it wasn't for a guardian angel watching over that kid, he'd never grow up? I mean, yeah. History and rabbinical writings tell us that Bezalel, when he was chosen of God to build this tabernacle, was 13 years old. Can you imagine a 13-year-old being called to build this tabernacle? I mean, it's great enough that he was called to do it, but how many of us, if we were told we were going to build a tabernacle, but our boss was this 13-year-old kid, would be willing to follow his orders and his leading to build this tabernacle? I know I'd find a little resentment in it, working for a 13-year-old, but he's the one that God had chosen. If we continue on in verse 3 there of chapter 31, it says, "And I have filled him," that's Bezalel, "with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship, to devise cunning works, to work in gold, in silver, and in brass, and in cutting of stones to set them, and in carving of timber to work in all manner of workmanship." Bezalel was called of God to be the master craftsman to build this tabernacle at only 13 years of age. We can see that a normal 13-year-old wouldn't have that ability to take on a task such as that. It had to be God behind him, giving him this ability to do all of this work, to be able to lead people who are a lot older than what he was, and not have them resent him telling them what to do and how to do it, showing them. Exodus chapter 12, verses 35 and 36 say, "And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses, and they borrowed of the Egyptians gold of silver and jewels of gold and raiment. And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they lent unto them such things as they required, and they spoiled the Egyptians." Not only did God provide a man, a boy, with the ability to build a tabernacle, but he gave them all of the material things that they needed to build this tabernacle. They're wandering out through a desert land headed for the promised land. Where are they going to find all the materials they need to build this tabernacle? God had miraculously provided it for them when he left Egypt. After God had performed all these miracles, these plagues upon Egypt, these Egyptians were so glad to get rid of those Jewish people, they gave them anything and everything they wanted just to get rid of them, to get them out of their land. And it says, the scripture here, "And they spoiled the Egyptians." They pretty much stole them blind. They took everything they had of value and left with it. I mean, if you can imagine more than a million people, they can haul away an awful lot of goods with them. And we continue on then in verse 5 or verse 6. It says, "And I beheld, and I gave unto him Aholiab, the son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan. Biblical names have special significance and meaning, don't they? Aholiab means God the Father is my tent. Rather interestingly, Aholiab, who was the partner with Bezalel in this building, was in charge of all of the textile fabrics that were needed for building this tabernacle. And his name meant God the Father is my tent. He was a tent maker, built this tent for the tabernacle. And Bezalel's name means in the shadow of God. God was there directing him. He was so close to God that he was in his shadow, listening to God directing him in this building effort. Verse 6 says, continuing on, and in the hearts of all that are wise-hearted, I have put wisdom that they may make all that I have commanded thee. The tabernacle of the congregation and the ark of the testimony and the mercy seat that is thereupon and all the furniture of the tabernacle and the table and his furniture and the pure candlestick and all his furniture and the altar of incense and the altar of burnt offering with all his furniture and the laver in his foot and the clothes of service and the holy garments for Aaron the priest and the garments of his sons to minister to the priest's office, and the anointing oil, and the sweet incense for a holy place. According to all that I have commanded thee, shall they do. They went ahead and built this tabernacle out there with all the covering of it, the tabernacle, the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat with all of the gold that was put into it to build it. Something beautiful, wasn't it? It tells us that Bezalel was of the tribe of Judah and Aholiab was of the tribe of Dan. When they were out there in the desert and the pillar of fire or the cloud was raised up from the tabernacle and moved, they were to follow that pillar of fire or the cloud. The first tribe that was to arise and start following was the tribe of Judah. The last tribe of the 12 was the tribe of Dan. So they represented the beginning and the end of all of the tribes to follow God. Revelation 22:13 says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. God speaking of himself. Rather interesting, isn't it? If we look at Exodus chapter 35, beginning in verse 30, it says, And Moses said unto the children of Israel, See, the Lord had called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And he hath filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship, to devise curious works, to work in gold, in silver, and in brass, in the cutting of stones to set them, and in the carving of wood to make any manner of cunning work. And he hath put in his heart that he may teach both he and Aholiab, the son of Ahisamach, of the tribe of Dan. Them hath he filled with wisdom of heart to work all manner of work of the engraver and of the cunning workman and of the embroiderer in blue and in purple and scarlet and in fine linen and of the weaver, even of them that do any work and of those that devise cunning work. Continuing on in verse 1 of the next chapter, Then wrought Bezalel and Aholiab and every wise-hearted man in whom the Lord put wisdom and understanding to know how to work all manner of work for the service of the sanctuary according to all that the Lord had commanded. And Moses called Bezalel and Aholiab and every wise-hearted man in whose heart the Lord had put wisdom even everyone whose heart stirred him up to come unto the work to do it. We read that not only were these two men called to the work, but God also stirred in the hearts of others to come and work with them. He gave them abilities also, didn't he? That they would come and work with these two that were leading the work there. In the New Testament, we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, it says, "What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? If ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Not only did the Old Testament saints have the Holy Spirit come down on them for special tasks to assist them, give them the abilities to accomplish that, but we have that same Holy Spirit in us today, don't we? Everyone who has accepted Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior have that Holy Spirit living within us. In Romans chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we read how that at the time that Holy Spirit comes to indwell believers, he gives gifts and abilities to that individual to enable them for service for God. Might not be as fanciful as what Bezalel or Oholiab did in building a tabernacle, but yet he gives each one of us abilities and gifts. Therefore, with having been given these gifts and abilities, what are we doing with them? When I was going through carpenter apprenticeship school back in early 1970s, I realized that during that four-year apprenticeship program that I had been given a gift, an ability that was beyond me. I just pretty much had to show up for apprenticeship class, and I got straight A's there. After 3.5 years, I was done. So the teacher had me helping him teach the beginning apprentices. It was a gift of God that he had given me. I began working for a big commercial contractor in Grand Rapids for 20 years. Unlike Moses, he spent 40 years on the backside of the desert, didn't he? God preparing him to come and lead the Jewish people out of Egypt. I was a quick study, only took me 20 years. Before God had given me the ability, the experience that I needed in carpentry and building to be able to serve him. And he called me to serve him as a missionary builder with Continental Baptist Missions. At that point in time, we told God that we would serve him for the rest of our lives as missionary builders. Well, 34 years later, the rest of my life is a lot closer than it used to be. Now that I'm 70 and I start having all these aches and pains, I got neuropathy in my feet, torn meniscus in both knees that I have to wait till the 1st of October to see a surgeon to try to figure out what to do with that. Got a sore throat this morning and an earache. I'm feeling my age. And helping my son-in-law yesterday put a roof on his garage down in Harrison, 24 by 48 garage, up and down the ladder and putting sheets of steel up there and stuff. I ache all over this morning. I feel my age, and I know that I'm not going to be able to serve God forever. He may come before I pass away, but I may very well die, and he calls me home to glory too. But who's going to take my place? Somewheres, God is working, stirring in the heart of somebody to take my place, just like I did Homer Baker, who was the founder of the building ministry with, at that time, it was called Hiawatha Baptist Mission. Brother Homer came and spoke in our church and showed the work that he was doing, and the Lord stirred me to go forward to give my heart and life to the Lord to become a missionary builder. But what about you? What has God given you gifts and abilities for? Quite probably isn't building. But there's other things we can do for God, isn't there? We can teach a Sunday school class. We can work in a nursery. We can clean the church so that looks honoring and pleasing to the Lord. And I forgot to turn my phone off, so I'm getting a text message reminding me of all of my messages that are in my spam blocker at the office. But we each have some ability that God has given us, and we need to be using that ability, don't we, to serve Him. Even if it's at home praying for missionaries, praying for your pastor, praying for others out there that are serving the Lord. That's an ability, a gift that you have of interceding before the throne of God for these individuals. For safety, for pastor, as he's driving around the Upper Peninsula, that he wouldn't have tires blow out on him, but be able to enjoy his trip up there. We all have gifts and abilities that we can use to serve the Lord. What are you doing with your gift and your ability? At this time, we've got a video clip, which goes quick. One of our missionary builders had set up a camera on a project down in West Virginia. I don't know if you remember us telling about this project, how the Lord works in strange and mysterious ways. But the church down there was a lady in the church. Her ex-husband got miffed at her, so he went and burnt her church down. I mean, burnt it right to the ground. There were just a couple block walls left of the church. But the church had been built in a 100-year floodplain. Unfortunately, they weren't real correct in that because it had been flooded in about 25 years three times. But he burnt this church down, so God provided insurance money for us to go down and build a new church for him up on high ground. They had a brand new church, which was bigger and better than the one that they had, and they had money left over because of God using what was meant for evil to turn out for good. But the church is completed now down there, and they're enjoying their new facility down there. And the lady whose ex had burnt it down has been welcomed by the church and probably given a medal for it. But they're enjoying their new facility there. And we enjoyed being able to go down and be there for their dedication service down in West Virginia there in Fort Ashby. During the Civil War time, there was a fort there and still is a building there called Fort Ashby. And just a little place out in the country there, as far south as they are, you could tell from the video there that they get winter numerous times. It comes and it melts and it comes and it melts and it comes and it melts. Doesn't stay very long at any one point in time like we have it up here. But I guess at this point in time, we better let you go before you faint from malnutrition. And we'll continue on this afternoon a little bit later then.